Hello, in today's video I'm going to talk about some training guidelines, things you can do, when you should do them, those kind of things. Nothing too specific, but just an overview and some guidelines. So if that's of interest, stay tuned. Okay, so today's video is about squash training, and this comes from a question from Callum Steele, who asked about the types of things that he should be doing to improve his squash, like fitness work. So I'm going to give you some guidelines. I'm not going to be, you've got to do this at 3 o'clock for, you know, 20 reps. I can't be too specific. But that's really what I want to say, that this is a guideline. It's not really going to be very specific training. So if you're looking for that kind of video, then this is not the video for you. And it's going to be quite long. So if you're looking for some, just like a 2 minute video, this is not going to be that video either. The second thing that I want to talk about is that I'm not a fitness expert. I don't consider myself to be an expert in anything, but my field of interest is skill acquisition and more sports psychology. So I'm going to give you an overview. There are more qualified people on the internet than I am, and they might contradict some of the things, but some of the things I'm going to tell you have come from experience, and obviously I've done courses and lots of things like that over the years, but I am not a fitness expert. Okay. Second thing I want to talk about is, in general, I feel the squash community is over-focused on fitness. Now, it would be silly of me to think that fitness is not a huge part of our sport, because it is. But in general, I feel that people focus too much on fitness and they focus too much on rackets. And I'm going to be talking about that in the next video or so. Fitness is important, and there are thousands of matches that would be won if people were fitter. But I prefer to think that the time and effort that's spent solely on fitness, some of that time would be better spent on acquiring new skills, being better squash players, not just being fitter. Being smarter squash players, knowing how to play the game, knowing how to hit the ball. So I just wanted to sort of preface that yes, you should be doing lots of fitness work, but don't neglect the other parts, because there are hundreds of matches that are lost every day, not because of fitness, but because of shot selection, or because of game plans, or because of not being able to technically hit the ball where you want to. So just wanted to put that out there. All right, now, before we really get started into the meat, one of the things that I want to talk about here . Be consistent. There's a video that you can see if you haven't already seen it. I made a video a little while ago about being consistent, about consistency, intensity, and rest. That, forgive me, I'm sorry. What you really need to do is you need to make sure that you work hard enough to really benefit yourself, but not so hard that you have to take extra rest or you get injured. You need to be thinking of, in your mind, be thinking of training camps. Now, a training camp will last approximately 6 to 8 weeks, and I'm not expecting you to go anywhere. What I'm expecting you to do, or hoping you to do, is think of them as, this is the period of time I'm going to train, and then after that maybe I'll take a week's rest, or I'll do something else, or I'll change things. But it's like a 6 weeks of intensive work. You cannot work for the whole season without breaks. It's not possible, and it's not good for you. So you want to work for 6 to 8 weeks where you really work on something. So I want you to be thinking about those, and we'll talk a little bit more about those later. I don't want you to be too ambitious. I would prefer that your targets are based on attendance, not performance. And what that means is that I would prefer you to finish the 6 weeks that you've worked less than you could have done, but you finish your 6 weeks of training. You've planned it, you've got it, you do it. If you say, I'm going to train at a certain amount, at a certain level, which we'll talk about in a moment, and I'm going to do 50 of those and I'm going to do 100 of those, you're maybe putting too much pressure on yourself, especially as these videos are all focused towards club players. They're not focused towards professionals or aspiring professionals. Club players, you have commitments. But if you can say, I'm so sorry. If you can say, I'm going to train 3 or 4 days a week, I'm going to do these kind of things, and then you can adapt it a little bit, that on that day you were hoping to do that, but you had to do a little bit less. That's okay, but as long as you finish the 6 weeks, that's what's important, especially for the first camp. If you can do the attendance ones, you've done all of your training sessions, no injuries, that's what's going to help you. That's why it's down to being consistent. So that's really what I want. Don't want you to be too ambitious, okay? Too ambitious is worse than no ambition. Next point I want to talk about. I want you to get a heart rate monitor. I cannot stress how important and how useful they are. They are not expensive. You can buy one for about 20 euros. I have a couple. I was hoping to bring them today, but I forgot, to be honest. I bought mine from a shop called Decathlon, which is like a European supermarket of sports. It's fantastic. I love it there. I paid 20 euros, and it just tells me my heart rate. It doesn't tell me anything else. Well, it's a watch, and it's a stopwatch, but it doesn't do anything else. And then I've got a more expensive one, a Polar, which is used for triathlons, and it can tell me the speed of my bicycle and how fast I'm running, as long as I've got all of those little gadgets. And it can record, and I can upload, and it's got all of those things. But the modern ones, I especially like the Polar M400. This is a fantastic model. It can do so many things. It can actually have your whole training program in it. But what I'm trying to say is, basic one is good. Top model, fantastic. But you should be getting one. You won't need it so much during your matches, because there's not really much that you can learn from during your matches. You can learn something, but not much. It's really about making sure that you don't work too hard and you don't work, you know, too low. And some of the middle range ones have got like settings where you can say, I want to work at this range. Essentially, you should be working between 60 and 80 for aerobic capacity, and then maybe between 75 and 85 for performance, depending on your age. Then if you're a little bit younger, you can go up. Plenty of videos on the internet about how to specifically use heart rate monitors, so I'm not going to cover that here. But when I don't have one, it feels like I don't have shoes and I'm playing on a squash court, for example. It just feels wrong. And over the years, I've got to know my body really well, but I still want one. I will drive back from the sports center to get my heart rate monitor rather than doing a training session without one. So okay. I get one. All right, good. So those are the main things here. What we're gonna look at now is we're gonna look at the season. Okay, and that's important. And we're going to split things into 3 seasons. We're going to split them into off-season. And we're going to cover some things. Now, when you're in the off-season, you're really looking to do endurance work. Basically, that's long workouts. Okay? Oops. Looking to build your aerobic capacity. You're looking for the basics. What we're looking for here is not short sessions, but long sessions. Sessions at a fairly high intensity, but not too high. I would like you to be doing some technical ghosting. Okay, now technical ghosting is where you're worried about the technique. You're not trying to do things as quickly as possible. So a little bit like the endurance work, technical ghosting sessions will be really about, am I getting my feet in the right way? Doing it properly. So you use the off season to improve your technique, and we can do that as well. Swings. This is where you would make sure that you have coaching, and we'll sort of put that in there as well. This is where the coaching really starts to pay off. You're not worried about playing your matches. You're off season, so you can play matches, but there's no tournaments and it's not so important. So it gives you a chance to really improve your technique. If you try and improve it in the middle of the season, it is possible, but you should be working on the smaller things. Sorry, just had to have a quick drink now. I was struggling. All right. And you can be thinking about increasing your flexibility. I don't really like talking about that too much during the mid-season because of other things. But off-season, you can certainly be increasing your flexibility because you've got a little bit more time available. We'll talk about the types of work later. All right, and then you've got pre-season. Well, what are you going to be doing at pre-season? So we'll underline that. Well, in pre-season, this is where you begin to increase the intensity. Okay. Not doing long sessions anymore. You make them a little bit shorter. All right. So imagine that this was the long session. Maybe you'd be doing an hour. This session here, you may be doing 40 minutes, but you've gone up by maybe 5 to 10% in intensity. You can still do the same kind of activity. We'll talk about that in a moment. But it's the time that you spend on it. You're working harder. That's what you're trying to do. Okay. Now, your main objective here is to avoid injuries. You do not want to get injured too early. So you're not going to be working maximum. You're not going to be doing anything that's a little bit dangerous. If there's any doubt in your mind whether you should be doing this kind of exercise, this jumping exercise, this new exercise, no, you avoid injury. Now, one of the things that I really wanted to talk about here that I forgot is in the solo practice, it's the basic strength exercises. The exercises where you just build up your strength, maybe lots of side to side. You're not looking to kill the ball that much. You can be. Remember, if you're working on your swings and your coaching, maybe you're introducing a new particular shot to your game, but you're really just getting stronger, getting lots of hits, getting your brain focused for long concentration sessions. All right. What we got next? All right. So here you can increase the kind of activity that you do. So maybe you've only been doing four or five different exercises here, but here, increase the range of activity. Now, whether that's to do with your solo exercises, whether that's to do with your on-court practice, you're increasing the shot. So if you were doing pair work here, again, it would be basic. Maybe looking for lengths, maybe some boasts, maybe some, you know, recovery shots and some volleys. And then here, when you're doing some pair work, well, you're allowed to maybe kill the ball a little bit more, looking for kills, for shorter shots. All right, next one is in season. In season. And here you're doing fast, intense workouts. Maybe you're only doing 20 minutes, but you're really working hard. You're warming up. You're warming up for 10 minutes, but you're really doing short, intense sessions. Now, in season, you can peak 3 times if you're lucky. Okay? So you need to think about what tournaments you want to peak for, and that's when you increase the intensity. Okay? You can be talking about small technical changes to your swing. Pair work would be more about all court things. Solo work, a wide variety. Whoops, couldn't spell wide there, sorry. Wide variety of shots. Here, you've been doing basic work. Here, you're just thinking about a little bit more, and here, you're doing all sorts of areas. So we've got, let's summarize here. You've got the off-season strength, core work, basic exercises, hitting, concentration, just to build up like a solid foundation. Pre-season, you're beginning to shorten everything, make it a little bit harder, but shorter. You're beginning to do shorter shots. You're beginning to look to kill the ball. You're looking to increase the range of shots and the different kind of activities that you do. Mid-season, or in-season as I've called it here, fast, short, intense work, because that's what's going to be happening on the court. You can still do the weekly long run, which used to be really popular, if you want to, if that's the sort of thing. When you do your pair work, you're playing all sorts. You're playing conditioned games, but the conditions are maybe a little bit more complicated. You know, I can't hit boasts on my backhand. He can't hit forehand volleys. You don't even have to tell your opponent that's what you're doing. You can play games where you sort of pick things out of a box and this is your condition and you just play. Another thing about that another time. Excuse me. Solo work is, well, you know, lots of different shots, hitting the ball up, cracking in the nicks, a little bit of everything, all right? So those are the basic ideas there. Now, let's take that. Let's move this over here. Solo work is basic work. All right, so now what we need to talk about, we need to talk about the types of activities, okay? So types of, oops. All right, we're gonna split them into different groups. Now you've got the basic, I keep using that word a lot today and I apologize, but you've got running, you've got cycling, you got rowing, you got the you got the elliptical, hopefully that's how you spell it, sorry. You got the elliptical trainer, you got, you know, all of those kind of things. Excuse me. And if you're doing endurance work, well, this is where you just go for your your long run. The run that takes 40 minutes, the run that takes an hour, the run that takes whatever is like hard work for you, and you do that. When it comes to increasing the intensity, if you wanted to do the running, well, you do shorter sessions. Maybe you do 5 minutes at 85% and then you have 2 minutes of rest. Then you do another 5 minutes, and then you have another 2 minutes or 3 minutes, and then you do another 5 minutes, and then you maybe have 4 minutes, and then you do the last session of 5 minutes. That's only about 30 minutes, including your warm-up. Don't forget your warm-up. That times that I've just given you, do not include your warm-up, 10 minutes warm-up. You do those, and it's still the basic exercise. Those basic exercises are good. They're good for the body in general. And we talk about being consistent, but what we don't want to be is we don't want to do the same thing every single time either, because that's bad for the body. If you only do one kind of exercise, that's really bad, okay? Now, if you're doing cycling, I love the indoor cycler. The spinning machines are fantastic. If you go out and you're new to going out, be careful. The roads can be dangerous places. So those are the basic exercises. You can even include swimming in there if you wanted to. Swimming can be quite hard. I'm not talking about recreational swimming. I'm talking about where you say, right, I'm going to go like 20 lengths and I've got to do it in like 25 minutes or something. I don't know. All right, so those are the basic ones. All right, and then we've got the specific ones. Now, the specific ones would be ghosting. Okay, we've got specific ones which would be ghosting. Agility ladder, which can be bought for 10 euros. And then sprints. So you can basically just do half court sprints. Now, you can use those, or some of them anyway, definitely ghosting in all three parts here. This is where we talked about the ghosting. If you look at my Facebook page, the Coach Philip Facebook page, you'll see my plan for my ghosting session during the summer. It was a 51 minute and 26 seconds ghosting plan, okay? It took me 50 minutes to do my ghosting. And of course I'm not actually ghosting for 50 minutes. I've got little breaks, got my plan. So ghosting can be used at any of those three points. When it gets down to in season, you can say I'm going to do a 20 minute session where I really work very hard, or even 15 or 10 minutes. One of the reasons I can't give you your training plan is because I don't know how fit you are. I don't know how often that you want to train. So that's why I'm trying to give you like a basic guide for you to sort of fit everything into where it should be and then try to do a few different sessions. All right. So agility ladder is basically a ladder that you put on the ground and you do some stepping. Look out for that in my ghosting video coming soon. And then sprints, of course, you can just go backwards and forwards, running as fast as you can. Be careful that you don't hit the walls, there are other people, but that's the kind of specific thing that can be useful for squash. Now, the next thing on my list here is general. All right, and the first thing we got is lightweights. And what I want to say about light weights is that I don't really like my pupils or to do heavy weights. I think it's bad for your timing. If possible, after you've done your light weights, try and hit the ball. I always found that it really didn't do much for my timing, but you need to experiment with that. Again, there's hundreds of videos on the internet. Essentially, what you're trying to do is reduce the number of weights, but increase the number of repetitions. That's not what the general advice is, because the general advice is for getting stronger and bigger, but we don't want you to be stronger and bigger. We want you to be powerful, and we want you to be able to hit the ball for like 1,000 times. Next things I want to tell you, and I'm in love with these things, is resistance bands. I think resistance bands are absolutely fantastic. Resistance bands, I love them. You can do all sorts of swinging exercises, great for the shoulder, the rotator cuffs, you can pull, there are hundreds of different exercises, and they're great for squash players because they recreate the kind of thing that you're doing. Very little weight, but you do it lots of times. I cannot recommend that enough. Next thing here would be yoga. Pilates, heck, even Tai Chi, etc. So basic floor work, getting on the floor, stretching, doing those kind of things, that is an essential part. And sort of in the off season, that's where maybe you'd be increasing your flexibility. Go for some yoga sessions. Yeah, I know that generally men don't, you know, respond to that kind of idea on Pilates. It's sort of it's a sexist thing to say, oh, the women do that, but it is a fantastic thing. The core strength that you need to do some of those yoga and some of those Pilates movements are fantastic. I cannot recommend it enough. I don't like it very much because I've got a bad back, but I cannot recommend it enough. Next thing which I am in love with is the Swiss ball. Let me put a red box around that as well. The Swiss ball is fantastic, not just for doing basic sort of strength exercises, but for balance exercises. It's really good. I mean, I'm not recommending you stand on it and hit figure of eights, which people do, but I'm not recommending that to begin with. But basic balance movements, you'd be so surprised that when you're better at balancing on those on the Swiss ball, how much better your movement is. Never neglect anything. One of my philosophies is try a little bit of everything, but don't neglect the smaller parts. Yeah, doing hundreds of hours of running on the streets and lunging is great, but there's a lot of core muscles that we don't use that will really help us. Cannot recommend this enough. And another thing that I quickly like, but I doubt most people will want to use, is a balance board. All right, a balance board is basically a semicircle with a circle at the top, in my case, a wooden circle, and you stand on it and you balance. You can even do some hitting exercises with it. All right, so those are the types of exercise. So one thing that I will finish with is try to vary what you do. Try to put it into the right season. So for Europeans, we are in season at the moment, at the time of this video, which is February. So you should be doing fast, intense work. But over the next couple of weeks, you'll have to start thinking about doing endurance work. And what you'll be doing is longer training sessions. If you're not sure what to do, just do something. Put it in here. You can write to me. But basically, I'd be thinking about an hour, about 40 minutes, about 20 minutes. Be consistent. Make sure you can do your 6 to 8 weeks. If you can't, if you're training too hard, drop it down, but make sure you can finish that. Now, I'm running out of time because I've got something to do immediately after this, so I can't do anything else. But I hope that that gives you a general idea of where you should be when you're doing the training. I haven't given you specific things, and I apologize for that. I will try to create something soon, maybe a PDF or a sample training session, but I won't guarantee it, but I'll try to do that. But hopefully that's of help. If not, then maybe you needed something more specific. So that's it, I finished for this one. So thanks for watching, and remember, do something every single day to improve your squash. Even if it's just a bit of yoga or the Swiss ball or the balance ball, that's something that helps you. That's it, thanks for watching. See ya.